Okay, guys, we're gonna start. So we're gonna start with some announcements, everybody. Donna, when I get this one wrong, you correct me, okay? Okay, so it goes like this. Scotia Charity Challenge is this Sunday, March 28th. The Mustard Seed is proud to be a part of the Calgary Marathon as a Scotiabank Charity Challenge partner. Sign up to run. Is everybody in this room signed up to run for the marathon? Two people. I think we got five runners, so we're doing good. Let Donna know if you want a free registration. Do you still give those away, Donna, or is that kind of done? A couple more left, okay. Or come down and volunteer and cheer. That'd be great. Calgary Corporate Challenge is doing a laser tag tournament for us. This is a Calgary event. It's taking place tomorrow. Corporate Challenge is still doing a laser tag tournament for us on May 25th at Laser Quest. We also get 25% off a discount code CCCFriend, right? Okay, everyone is welcome to participate. It's adults only, but you don't have to be a staff of TMS. So if you are staff of TMS or not, you're able to go and do that. And that's what you do. Our next speaker next week is, it says here, the legendary CEO, Steve Weil. I don't know why they always have to put legendary in there for him, but there it is. And this week we're going to do something a little different. And we've never tried this before, so if it doesn't work, it's my fault. I'll take the blame. But a couple years ago, we started to do spiritual care training with our staff and how to build a culture of spiritual conversation. And so what we thought we were going to do today is there's five staff. We're going to share a testimony of how that went for them. And the only thing I told the different areas here, Edmonton, Shelter, downtown, is they can't be chaplains. They're giving these testimonies. They have to be staff that work in other departments. And so we're going to go in the following order. Red Deer's going to be up first, and that's Chef Sue. And then we have the Shelters, Tanya Hernandez. Edmonton has Rachel McEwen. And then Calgary has Crystal Sayers and Amit Nod. Or what are the next two at the very end? So you guys are up last. Okay?
We lost Edmonton.
Did we lose Edmonton? We lost Edmonton. Okay, let's get him back. Yes. These chairs? Yeah. The legendary Steve CEO has asked if we could all move our chairs a little closer to the front.
Oh, I'm right in there.
See, I look at they just much better. Because I felt alone. All by my lonesome. Okay. Okay. Leo, you work on getting Edmonton back. We're going to start with the Red Deer, okay?
Perfect. All right.
Okay, so for our first staff is from Red Deer, and so we would like it's Chef Sue. And Byron, is anything you want to say first?
No, it's not Chef Sue now. We had a change of plans. It's the amazing, outstanding Brian Snyder. So Brian's going to introduce himself and share with everyone today.
There you go. That's good. There we go.
Morning, everyone.
So I am not a public speaker by any means, so this is kind of out of my box. But I did have some words for some encouragement today. First of all, I'm the driver here at Red Deer. And I was pretty hesitant when Byron asked me to do this. So he sent me a text and said, do a 5-minute talk on spiritual conversation that I've had with a guest or client. And I really couldn't come up with anything. So I prayed about it and nothing came. So last night I was kind of sitting in my own headspace, and we had a pretty cool thing happen last week. We had our first baptism here. So that was really cool. Short story was Monday night we had our regular Bible study. Thanks, Byron. So during the Bible study, one of our clients, Kim, she had some questions about baptism and what it meant and stuff like that. And she was baptized as a young kid. So kind of went through that, and she said, should I get baptized again? So our chaplain, Shane, was here, and he said, well, Kim, you know, if you want to, we can do it. And she goes, well, where's the dunk tank? So, of course, we don't have a dunk tank here. And Shane, he brought out Acts 8, where Philip, he baptized the Ethiopian eunuch just on the side of the road. So Shane goes and he gets some water and comes back, and he's like, well, we're going to baptize you right here, right now. And Kim didn't really understand that she could just get baptized anywhere. So Shane asked her, you know, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And she replied, yes. And so she professed her faith in Jesus, and we baptized her. And sorry, a little bit emotional about this one. So I guess on this walk, you don't really get to see some of the fruits of the seeds that you sow. So I got to witness somebody else's seeds getting harvested, which was really cool. I just wanted to give you guys some encouragement about those tough conversations that we have with people and guests, and just to know that you might not see what's going on in their heart, but somebody else will. And I got to do that, so I was very grateful for it. So that's my little story.
Next, we have Tanya from the shelter.
I know, but now it's set up. I should look at it.
Like, yeah.
Can everybody hear me? Okay. This is like so awkward. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you, Byron, for sharing. You're not going to be alone in terms of the emotional thing. I'm known as a big cry over here myself. So anyway, so thank you for being brave and courageous to share that story. My name is Tanya, and I've been working at the shelter now for just over a year. And when I first started, I felt severely underqualified for this job. I don't have any background in addictions counseling or social work or anything of that nature, but I felt God's calling towards here. And when I first started, I just remember asking him just to use me. in whatever way that he saw fit, given my own capabilities and skills and things of that nature. And well, he's been answering that prayer ever since then, pretty much on a daily basis. He's always providing different opportunities to share the gospel, either through words or through action. And I spoke a little bit last week at the Lunch for a Lifetime about having an obedient heart. And that message was really inspired by one particular moment here at the shelter that was really pivotal for me in terms of my own spiritual growth and my work here at the shelter. And so that's what my story is going to be about. the shelter, we open at 4, and so I was just walking around the mat area where there was a lot of people there already. And I felt God telling me to speak to a certain person who was walking my way. And so the guest was approaching me, and I said, "Hello, how are you doing?" And, you know, usually you expect someone to answer in the positive, or "I'm fine, things are great." But in this context, it's likely that the person is maybe not going to answer that way. And so then it becomes awkward, right? So I said, so he told me, "Well, I'm not doing too well." And I said, "Why?" And he said, "Well, I've recently been diagnosed with prostate cancer." And I said, "Wow, I'm really sorry to hear that." And then he said, "Yeah, I don't even know if I'm going to make it until Christmas." And he said, "Really? Is that what you were told?" And he said, "No, I have an appointment tomorrow with the urologist, and they're going to tell me whether or not the cancer is operable." So then I said, "So why are you already, crossing yourself off? You don't have any idea whether or not it's operable." And then at that moment, I felt again the Holy Spirit prompting me to offer this guest prayer right then and there. And I had already been I've always been nervous about praying in front of others. And now there's over 100 people walking around in these things. And I was just getting nervous. I started to sweat real hard. And and in my weakness, and in my human doubt, I was thinking, "Oh, if I offer him prayer, he's probably just going to say no, and then you're going to feel stupid and rejected, and that's going to be it." But I had a decision to make in that moment, whether or not I was just going to trust the prompting of the Holy Spirit and ask him if I could pray for him, or if I was going to back down and just let that moment pass by. And so for me, that was like a big leap of faith, and I asked him. Oh, I said to him, I said, "Well, we serve a great God, a God that's capable of any kind of miracle, that there's no diagnosis that's outside of his power to heal." And so I said, "Would you mind if I prayed right now for your situation and ask God for a miracle?" And to my surprise, almost, he said, "Yeah." He says, "Sure." And he said, "But I want you to know, Tanya, I'm not a religious man," he said. And I said, "Well, that's all right. God is going to hear our prayer anyways." And so then I prayed for a miracle. And I asked God just to demonstrate, for him to be glorified by granting this miracle, because we know that there is no situation that is greater than him, that his power knows no boundaries and no limits. And so I prayed that for him, and then he told me that after his meeting tomorrow, he would come find me, and he would let me know what happened. And so the next day, I saw him because he had approached me because he had just come in, and I was giving out meals for people that were coming in late. And he comes up to me with a big smile on his face, and he says, "Well, I have good news." And I said, "Really?" And he said, "Yeah." He said, "They told me that it's 100% operable." And I said, "Well, that's so great." And he said, "Well, yeah, you prayed." And I was like, I was just so shocked inside, because it's like, this was coming from a man who yesterday thought he was not going to make it for the next few months, and who didn't even know that God was if he was going to listen to our prayer or not. And now he's confirming the fact that his prayer was answered because we prayed about it. And so then I said, would you mind if I say a quick prayer to, just to thank God, a quick prayer of thanksgiving to thank God for answering our prayer? And he said yes. So I did that really quickly. And so, well, I don't have an update. I haven't seen him. I only saw him a few more times after that. But that was really pivotal for me, because I think sometimes maybe we think we're not the most eloquent speaker, or we're not going to say the right thing, or, you know, we don't have, you know, all these lists of capabilities and things like that. But I think if God is prompting us to do something, it's because he believes that we are capable, and we, that should be enough for us to just be obedient in that moment and to just trust that he's going to take care of the rest. And so it's been getting easier ever since that moment to just trust and just let God do the rest and plant those seeds. So I guess my encouragement for today is for everyone to try and take those leap of faith whenever God presents you with those opportunities, to love on our guests and share the message of hope that we find in the gospel. Thank you for listening.
Do we have Edmonton back? Oh, they got a power outage. Well, then that's good that Deb's team has two speakers this morning, right? So we're going to go with Crystal and we'll go with Amit. Is it all here? Oh, right
there. No. Stand up. Sit down. Yeah. That's fine. Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Amit, and I'm a housing caseworker. I've been working with the Seed since 2013, and I've had many insightful conversations with our clients, and it's been a great journey working with the Seed and to do the things that we get to do here, to talk about God and to do things that Christ has called us to do. I'll just share two stories very quickly. I'll share about Anoop's story, and I'll share about Lito. He's one of our clients who will be graduating by the end of this month. But as I think about these two stories, I think about the parable of sower, where the sower sows seeds, and he sows on four different grounds, and there are different results. But we, as the staff here at the Mustard Seed, we sow our seeds, like, you know, by doing our jobs, by following a professional lifestyle and everything. But some or the other way, we are sowing seeds of Christ in the lives of those we are serving. Story of Anoop reminds me of the seeds sown in his life by Christians all around. When he started facing struggles, the chaos in his life in 2009. For Indian cultural people, Canadian culture is totally different. And for Anoop, this was the greatest struggle. When he came to Canada, he was living here and everything, but when alcoholism kind of, you know, took him down, he had to face a lot of consequences for that. He had to be separated from his wife, and he had to be separated from his kids. Since his kids were 7 and 11, he did not see them because of the restraining orders, because of alcohol and everything that went against him. And this man has not shared this story with anyone till May 4th. He shared this with me. On May 4th, we had like a conversation for 2.5 hours, and I was just able to see the journey, how this guy has like seen the work of Christ in his life, but he was not able to recognize that it is Christ. He's going through all this turmoil in his life since 2009 and facing restraining orders, but being an Indian man, he does not really believe in all these rules and regulations. As Indians, you know, we break a lot of rules while we are driving. Just kidding. We are good drivers, sorry. So Anoop was going through that phase of his life. He was not able to understand the restraining orders and whatnot. And even Leto, that I'm going to talk about, he also did not understand all these restraining orders. He kept breaking those rules. He kept showing up at his home and showing up at his wife's place, and his wife calling police and taking him into, again, police station and everything. Anoop was going through a lot of problems, but the probation officers that came in his life helped him understand the grace of Christ, but he was not able to understand it. Alcohol was all over him. But on May 4th, this man, I don't know, all of a sudden, I don't know why this happened. Like, he started sharing about all the significant people that came in his life and showed mercy to him at every occasion. Probation officers could have given him any, you know, any kind of punishment for whatever he was doing. But most of them were gracious to him. Next time, a different probation officer came to him. Her name was Natalie, and this probation officer was tough love kind of a probation officer. And this is how Anoop was trying to explain to me everything that is happening in his life. And I was like, I was listening for 2 hours. I was not saying a word. I was just trying to listen to him, what he's trying to tell me. And then I just told him, Anoop, you have just shared with me something that a Christian would do when he is called to serve the Lord. They will just sow the seeds. They will keep on doing what Christ has called them to do in the lives of those who are there, who they are serving. And Anoop was not able to recognize that. Even in DI, when he was there, he had a fight with different people, went with a lot of struggles, had broken jaw and everything. And the doctors that came in his life showed the grace of Jesus. And on that day when he was sharing this, I was able to connect all the dots for him, and I was able to help him understand that this is what Christ has called us to do. As we are serving him, we are there to just serve God, and this is how you find Jesus through our lives. And then I was able to help him connect with Chaplain David, and now he is continuously talking with Chaplain David regarding Christ and getting to know him better. And even in, now he's in shelter, actually. Like, you know our clients, he went through a tough time after this story. He got evicted from his house, but now he's at the shelter with a broken leg, and he's still having these insightful conversations. Luis is there. I heard yesterday from Anoop that Luis is helping him. Tanya is helping him talk about Jesus' love. So this is amazing of how we are as a whole sowing the seeds in the lives of our clients in any way. And the next story is about Leto Anithin, just a very quick glimpse of his story I'll give you. On November 30th, Katsala handed him over to me and said that this client has been not connecting. He's supposed to move from his other house to the 1010 center, but he's not connecting. And I was done on that day. Like, it was all over 5 o'clock, and my time was done. I should have gone home, but something prompted in my heart and said that you should go and see this client tonight. And I went there at 5:30. I knocked at his door, and he was broken and he was lost. He said to me that if you did not show up that night, he would have ended everything, because he was going through a very, very hard time. He lost his family as well. He lost his kids. Like, he's not able to connect with them just because of the restraining orders against him, and he's got difficulty in communication. But this is what, like, you know, you say the prompting of the Holy Spirit. I just went, stood with him, and I told him, I want to work with you and find you a good home. And that night he just hugged me. He said, thank God, thank you for showing up at my door. I thought I lost all my hope. Then I worked with him, and we all know that he made a wonderful success, you know, as one of our clients. He went and stayed at 1010 Center. Now, this client has a full-time job, and he works at Harmony Beef as a professional butcher. And the most important thing for me is that he has connected back with his wife. He lives with her now, and he is back with his kids, and he is the happiest person. But one of the things that kind of stood out to me was our continuous prayers for our clients. they do really matter. Because somewhere down the line, Holy Spirit is working in their hearts. And at the right time, he speaks to them. So for Lito, he was so scared to face the government for his court trials and everything. Every time the court trials came to him, he was like, no, I don't want to go. I cannot talk to them. I do not want to face them because they're going to put me back into these restraining orders and whatnot. And he had so many tickets and so many fines that he had to deal with. One day he shared this with me. He's like, Amit, I want you to come with me to the court. I said, yes, definitely. I'm your caseworker, so this is my job. This is like nothing new to me. So I'll come with you. Don't worry. And I show up at this courtroom, and for some reason, he forgot to tell me what is the courtroom number. And I was looking for him here and there, and he was not able to find me. The phone's not working, and everything was really tough. And as he is in the courtroom, I somehow find this courtroom, and I go there, and he is facing his struggles himself. Like, he is standing before the judge, and I could see him that he is facing. And he was talking to them about his struggles and what all had happened, who stole his car, and what was those tickets about and everything. And we have had insightful conversations about Jesus before this thing. And judge listened to everything and asked him, Lito Anitin, do you have $10 in your pocket? He said, yes, I do have $10. I have a full-time job now, and I'm willing to pay all your tickets, but don't put me into trouble. That's what he said. She said, if you have $10, go to the second floor, pay $10, and all the things that you owe to the government is everything taken care of. And he was like, he was crying like a baby. He was crying like a baby in that courtroom, and that was joy. And the first thing that he said was, thank you, Jesus. And that was one of the important things that motivated me to have more, you know, passion to do my work here at the Seed, is that whatever we do, we are doing in the name of Christ, and somewhere down the line, it is working in the lives of our clients. So thank you so much for this time.
Just kidding. I'm feeling kind of short, so we'll hold this down. I'll keep this really quick. So my story is, actually, I went away. I had an aunt who was in hospice, and I felt very prompted to go and see her. And I knew that probably nobody else would be sharing the gospel with her. And I knew she didn't know Jesus. So I went there, and I actually had the opportunity to lead her to Christ before she passed away. She passed away about just under 2 weeks away, two weeks after that. I came home, and I'm all pumped, and I'm like, oh, this is so awesome. Oh, my gosh, God, you're so great. And it had been so many years since I led somebody to the Lord. Anyway, I had a meeting with a client who was graduating that month. It was in March, and I just had the opportunity. We were kind of just going through some reports and assessments and all the usual closing stuff, and then we had a conversation about, you know, sort of church, and he had been to church. He actually was from Sudan and, you know, went to church on a relatively regular basis. He believed in God, believed in Jesus, and I said, well, you know, have you ever given your heart to him? Have you ever given your life to him? And he kind of kept changing the subject, actually. And I just kept bringing it back. And I said, you know, if you were to die tonight, do you know, would you go to heaven? And he said, I don't know. And we talked a little bit more. And about, I shared with him about Jesus and how God is, you know, just the whole gospel story about how God has come to redeem our lives, and he can give his life to Christ, and he can be assured of salvation and be assured that he is with him every day. And I said, would you like to do that? And he said, yes. And so I was able to lead him in a really simple prayer to Christ, and he was just like, Crystal, thank you so much. I will never forget you. I will never forget the mustard seed. I will never forget Aaron, who was his caseworker before I was at some point. And anyway, and it just was just so great to be able to have the opportunity to share the gospel, because we sow seeds every day, as we've been talking. Everything we do is a seed that is sown in that person's life. But to be able to have that moment with them where they actually are not just assured of heaven, but they actually can have a relationship with God here on earth. And that's really what it's about. And it was so exciting, and was just such a blessing, not only to myself, but our team and really about what we're about as we're housing people, as we're building relationships, you know, and talking with them, you know, here we are, we have those opportunities. But if we don't ask how, like, if we don't talk, if we don't share, you know, God's love, if we don't ask them if they want to receive Jesus, then how will they receive Jesus? Because they won't know. And I just, it was just that reminder, and I thought, man, this guy, he's gone to church all this time, and he's never really given his life to Christ. And now, right, church has much more meaning because you begin to understand as you develop that relationship with him. So thank you for everybody that did it, because I just kind of came along a few months after, or a few months before he graduated, but there were other people who sowed into his life. So, and he stayed in the shelter and everything. So it definitely has a major impact. Blessings.
Can they hear us? Oh, the power's out. Okay. Okay, who didn't pay the bill? Okay. Yeah, well, wasn't that great today? Just to hear these stories, you know, I'm always so impressed with the power of story and how it can impact a life. So thank you, all of you who shared, because it's very significant. One of the things that I saw that you likely noted as well is how in all the stories there's the prompting of the Holy Spirit. And I think that's, you know, that's something that we need to recognize, because as you're doing your work, you know, the Lord is going to be prompting you to, you know, to pray for somebody or talk to somebody or just even interact with them. And we need to be sensitive to that Spirit. So I just want to encourage you to be listening for God's prompting as you work with those you're working with. Next week, give a little plug for next week, you know, and the speaker next week. We're talking next week about what does it mean to be Christian in the mustard seed? And I think that we need some clarity there, because a lot of times they say, I don't really know what it means in this environment to be a Christian. What does it actually mean to be a Christian in our society? So that's kind of the topic for next week, and hopefully we can bring at least some clarity of what our position is going to be as an organization. So I encourage you to come back. Let me just close in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for today. I want to thank you for the just the stories that were shared, the impact that we're having on people's lives. Father, I pray that you would help us, each one of us, to be sensitive to your Holy Spirit, to listen to your voice, and to obey your promptings. Father, we know that you love us, you love our guests, you love all those that we work with. And Father, we just pray that we would be a faithful, loving witness of who you are. So Father, I just pray for each one of us that as we go from here, that you would give us the opportunity to share your love, whether in word or in deed, but to share your love with those that truly need a touch from you today. And we'll thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Blessings. Take control.